Welcome back. The great debate between Scott Morrison and Anthony Albanese is over, and it's time to find out who won. We had 19,000 votes come through from our viewers and listeners. We asked you who won tonight's great debate, and this is your verdict. A win for Scott Morrison, 52% declaring him as the overall winner, 48% chose Anthony Albanese. Now, I want to ask our panel, Chris, does that surprise you at all?
Scott Morrison is a powerful performer. I think on some things, Anthony Albanese has a halting kind of presentation which may put people off. I thought, you know, he pretty much, from my point of view, held his own with Scott Morrison, and I think Scott Morrison's got to win and win by a lot in this circumstance at the moment. So, no, I'm not surprised by those results, and it's a reasonably clear victory to the Prime Minister based on a fairly big sample. Apparently there are a lot of problems trying to get through it as we got towards the end. So, yep. But still, 20,000 is a lot of people.
It sure is, and I guess it gives us a bit of an impression. We know, obviously, Scott Morrison is more experience in these kinds of formats. Deb, is that how you saw it?
He's a skilled communicator, and we know that. And I think on the face of it, his conviction comes through very strongly, and he can prosecute an argument with great skill, and he did that tonight. And Anthony Albanese, he looks rattled at times, but I think it was pretty evenly matched tonight, the performance between the two of them. And I think, you know, having that, it's not a resounding success from our viewers and listeners tonight, but I think it was fairly closely matched. But I think in terms of the skill as an orator and as a debater, I think Scott Morrison has that superiority over Anthony Albanese.
It felt evenly matched in the studio, I thought. I mean, they both stepped it up. I think it's interesting that Scott Morrison could often be more assured on policy detail. He was, I thought on aged care, for instance. So maybe that's what actually communicates to viewers out there, that he's got that sense of confidence about his own policies. But I've got to say, I think Anthony Albanese did land some blows there, I thought. And I think he had the advantage of the closing remarks.
His closing
remarks. That's not my job. He sort of nailed it in terms of getting it exactly on the time and delivering the prepared remark that he'd been wanting to get through all night. So he got, I think, what he wanted out of it. But it's interesting that the wider audience gives some credit, I think, to Scott Morrison's policy detail knowledge.
I mean, I think they certainly, Anthony Albanese stood his ground. And what we have to remember as well is these men are fierce opponents, right? They sit opposite each other for 18, 20 weeks a year. So they are attacking each other all the time. This was an opportunity for them to do that, kind of on their own terms. There wasn't an audience there to sort of put them off. Do you think that helped, Deb?
I think it's a fine line for them because they don't want to come across as being aggressive and being too overbearing because, you know, in this sort of studio format, it's very different to Question Time, where we know that it does get very heated and very fiery. But we did see elements of that tonight. We definitely did. And, you know, they weren't going to take any steps back and they stepped forward, and apart from their questions to each other being far too long.
We weren't sure that they were going to be like that.
No, exactly.
I mean, I actually thought that they would play it a bit safer than that. But we are in the final 2 weeks. The stakes are so high. And I think there's a sense that, well, we know, for instance, in tomorrow's Financial Review, there's polling showing that Labor's ahead, maybe reflecting some of what we're getting in the audience reaction tonight. Scott Morrison probably knows that and probably knows that he's got to step it up against Anthony Albanese.
And the figures are very much the same, as I understand it, in News Poll as well, which shows that the gap is now widening between the Coalition and Labor, which Labor's now beginning to pull a little bit ahead. So that's why I think, you know, the Prime Minister really did need to step it up tonight. And I wonder too if because one of the key questions over Anthony Albanese that the government's trying to raise is weakness, is that physically tonight he decided he would step up and be that strong presence in the face of Scott Morrison, who's a big man. Like, that's the other thing too, is that Scott Morrison has a large presence and a large...
You notice that in the studio.
Yeah, you do.
Less so on TV.
Well, now, we do have to stress that this is, of course, not a scientific poll. This is the verdict of our viewers who chose to participate. At the conclusion of the debate, we asked, decided or not, which are you more likely to vote for at the election, Labor, the Coalition, or somebody else entirely? Now, you told us 46% are leaning towards the Coalition, 48% towards Labor. That's pretty close. 6% are leaning towards a third party or an independent. You know, that's really interesting because we're seeing these independents with so much momentum. 6% is not a great number.
No, but the undecideds have come way down there on what we have seen, which means that at least the people that were watching us were engaged tonight. So that is a big shift on that, a two-point difference between the two parties. The government wouldn't be entirely disappointed by that, because that means that this election is still alive. And going on the public polling, it looks more and more like that's not the case. So, you know, it's a fascinating result. And the fact, too, that people engaged, I think, is a great thing.
How will this resonate with Age and Sydney Morning Herald readers, do you think, David?
Well, I think that they're watching with interest. And it's hard to tell whether... Well, let me put it this way. A lot of our readers are in the cities where the teal candidates are putting up a big fight. Now, what we've seen here is that 6% are voting for other. But that's a national figure. Mm. And what really counts with some of these contests is what's happening in eastern Sydney, the inner suburbs of Melbourne, even some Brisbane seats where there's a bit of the same dynamic coming on. And that's what's really hard to figure out in this campaign. What is going to happen in those areas like North Sydney, around here, and whether the support for other is actually a lot more than 6% in those kind of crucial seats in this campaign.
Yeah, because we're seeing very different campaigns here. There's the campaigns in the individual seats with the moderate Liberals who are facing the fight of their life against the so-called teal independents.
Sorry, could I interrupt? Sorry, Deb. Your question to Scott Morrison about when is he going to campaign in some of these seats was fascinating, because he kind of made it look like he was going to. Let's see whether he actually does, because we know that that's a risk.
He was campaigning with the Treasurer today.
He was speaking to the Treasurer today, but not in Kooyong.
He wasn't in Kooyong, that's for sure. Now, we do have some breaking news that I want to address right now. Again, this is only a snapshot of our viewers tonight, but it's a substantial number of votes, and both parties I'm just getting in my ear now. We've had up to 30,000 votes that have just come in on who won the debate tonight. And, in fact, it's shifted. Mm. So now Anthony Albanese is sitting on 51% and Scott Morrison on 49%. So those numbers are literally just coming through. They are climbing. So people are persevering with that QR code.
Like election night.
And it's just flipped.
It's a cliffhanger. It is like election night.
It is.
Yeah.
So at this stage you'd say, well, you know what, David? I think it's too close to call.
But if you had to choose, Chris.
Well, you go 51-49, there's a winner.
Is that how you saw it?
Oh, look, you know, as I said, I thought that the debate, in fact, in the room, felt to me like it was reasonably even. And in all of these contests, Scott Morrison must win and win really quite substantially. And I felt that one of the things he was hoping to do tonight was to force Anthony Albanese into an obvious error, and that didn't come.
Like, he certainly tried. He certainly pushed.
He gave it his best shot.
Yeah.
And it's fascinating to see, you know, how it all pans out.
51-49, I mean, in any polling, that's within margin of error, right? It's so close. And it did feel that close
evenly matched.
Now, we do need to get to the late news, but very quickly, I'd like your final thoughts, David.
Well, my final thoughts, I guess, are that Anthony Albanese is now performing better than we saw earlier in the campaign. He's really got to keep that up for the next 2 weeks. We know from 2019 that where the parties were 2 weeks out from polling day didn't reflect the outcome, because Scott Morrison was campaigning so cleverly in the final days of the 2019 campaign. And with a result this close, you can see that that's still possible. So I'd say to everybody, don't... In fact, what Anthony Albanese said to me in an interview the other day, no assumptions, making no assumptions. And I think that'd be good advice right now with this election.
Deb?
I just think as we go into these final 2 weeks, even though the polls are already opening tomorrow, so people will be casting their votes, but these final 2 weeks, Anthony Albanese cannot afford to make any more mistakes that he has done. No more NDIS moments. And it's all good and well to complain about gotcha moments from the media, but he has to be on his game. He was well prepared tonight and it showed. And he has to continue that momentum moving through these final 2 weeks, because it is close. And, you know, he performed well tonight, but I think if there's any slip-ups, that will definitely resonate and that'll be used as a weapon against him.
Chris, you had the final question. You'll have the final thought.
Oh. Well, this is the time when the rubber hits the road now for Anthony Albanese. He reminds me of a football player who decided that he would get fit during the season, which is not really a great way to go about your game. He should have hit the ground running on day one. He's had his real stumbles. Unfortunately, up until this point, the best week that Labor had was when he was off the road. But I think that he brought a much better game to bear tonight. He will need to make sure that he is flawless between now and the end of the campaign, because if it is as close as it seems, then this election can still be won. But the sense of it is that the coalition is coming from behind. Scott Morrison has a lot of ground to make up.
Well, I've just had the numbers trickle through again, and it is now a dead heat. We have 50-50.
Oh, it is just
and
my
that's,
collection.
And that's based on in excess of 30,000 votes, I might add. So thank you. Thank you, of course, to our panel. Thank you to you at home for watching and for participating in this evening. That is where we'll leave our 60 Minutes special event.